Hello everyone, my name is Mustafa Al-Zantout. I am PhD candidate at UCLA.
Hi, my name is Yash Sharma. I'm a visitor at Cornell.
Our talk today about practical adversarial attacks in challenging environments is a joint work with my advisor, Professor Mani Srivastava from UCLA, Shubhru Chakraborty from IBM Research, and Sram Swami from ARL, and all other collaborators. Of course, everyone here in the audience knows that artificial intelligence is playing a big role in our lives today. It is used in different applications like self-driving cars, e-health, automated surveillance, and fraud detection. And as you notice, many of these applications are security critical and safety critical applications. So we need to have an accurate artificial intelligence models. And most of these models of artificial intelligence rely on what's called machine learning, which starts with having a set of trained data. Then you apply a training algorithm or learning algorithm on this training data to learn a model. And this model, it hopes to understand what is the patterns that exist in the training data, and then generalize later to distant data at the inference time. This learning model is often deploy it as a service where like users can feed some new test data, and this data will produce an output prediction from the model. But if we have an attacker or a malicious user, he can manipulate the new data in order to force the model to produce some desired outputs. Here is an example. Of course, we know that all humans are good. Humans are good at recognizing objects. So it's easy for a human to tell which image, like the first image is a panda and second one is a school bus. Even a small kid can do this task and do it very well. But not only humans are good at object recognition right now. Machines are also getting better. So a decent computer vision algorithm can also tell like the first image is a panda and second one is a school bus, and they can do this with very high accuracy. It was even in 2014 that the best machine learning model for computer vision on the ImageNet dataset, it could achieve the human accuracy on the same dataset. So it can have a superhuman accuracy. But does this mean that we are now at the point at which we can rely on machine learning in doing all our tasks? Given that the tasks are mostly safety and security critical applications, and machine learning can do it even more accurate than human. Let's take this example. Here is the same image we have shown before, like a human and a machine, both of them can recognize it correctly. And if there is a malicious user or an attacker, he can add some small, cleverly computed perturbation noise to this image, such that the result, it still looks for me as a school bus. So a human who looks at the output image, the one to the right, he will say, okay, this is still a school bus. But the machine learning model who previously recognized the original image correctly with very high accuracy, it will now be fooled. It will say this is an ostrich. And that's a serious threat, because the attacker can even have control on what would be the output misclassification label by the machine learning model. So he can force the model to produce the output he wants it to predict. And this idea is known as adversarial attacks or adversarial examples. It was first discovered in 2014 by Suzuki et al, which have noticed that in their paper called Incongruent Properties of Neural Networks, they have noticed that small perturbation in the input can lead to significant output changes in the output. And for example, when they add this small noise to this school bus image, it will now be predicted as an ostrich instead of a school bus. And at the same year, Ian could follow. He started studying this phenomena more in his paper called Explaining and Harnessing Adversarial Examples. And he came up with a method called FGSM, or Fast Gradient Sign Method, which is an efficient method to compute what would be the adversarial noise. What would be the small perturbation we can add to the original image to cause the model to misclassify or misproject? And the idea is very simple. So given an input image, he computes the loss of the model for this input image, and then he computes the gradient of the loss with respect to the input, and then he takes the sign and adds this to the original image after scaling it down, so that the perturbation will be small. And the intuition here is that the loss is a quantification of the error produced by the network, and the gradient of the loss is the direction at which it will maximize this error rate. And during the training, you add to the weights some update in the opposite direction of the gradient of the loss to minimize the error. But if you want to make the model misclassify or misproject, you need to add an update to the input in the direction of the gradient of the loss. And by applying this, instead of having the model predicting the left image as a banda correctly, it will now say it is a gibbon with 99% accuracy. So it is not only wrong, but it is wrong with very high confidence. And this happens 4 years ago, but right now, after 4 years of research, we have a lot of updates in this domain. Like, a lot of researchers studying this phenomena, and there have been many other attack methods for generation of adversarial attacks. For example, there is the projected gradient descent, there is the deep fall, Carlini and elastic network, and Houdini, and many others. But all of these share a common thing. They rely on the same idea introduced by Ian Goodfellow in 2014, which is computing the loss of the network, finding the gradient, and then adding some perturbation in the direction that maximizes the loss. But not only in researchers have been studying attacks, they have been also studying like defense. And there is a software library called the IBM Adversarial Robustness Toolkit. And there is another software library called the Clever Hands, which is like a benchmark of attacks algorithm implemented for researchers to use. And there is competitions organized around this domain, like the NIPS 2015 competition and the CAC competition that we had yesterday in this conference. And yeah, one of the recent updates in this domain is the adversarial batch work, which is like the following. Researchers have found that they can have a printed physical batch that if you put it like next to any object, then a machine learning model looking at the image of this object, it will misproject it. So for example, the original image, if you have a banana and take a photo of it and feed it into the machine learning model, it will say it is a banana with 99% accuracy. But if you put this small piece of sticker paper next to it, take another photo, then it will say like it is a toaster with a 99% accuracy. And this is a physical world batch. This is not a modification of the image. This is something you put it like next to the banana in the physical world. So cool. Does this mean, are we done with this problem? Like, is everything solved? The answer is, we believe it is no, because there are a lot of remaining open challenges. And our purpose of the talk today is to introduce to you like a few of these open challenges. Like, not all of them, because there exist many open problems, but we wanna like highlight some few open challenges and what research work we have done in this domain. So the first one is like how to attack machine learning models while you are having only limited access to this model and only limited knowledge about the model. Second one is how to attack machine learning models that's not doing only images, but other things like natural language, understanding models. And third one is to how achieve physical world-like attacks against speech recognition models. So to start with the first one, let me recap and give you a reminder of how to compute adversarial examples. Remember what we have said about we need to compute a small perturbation that will maximize the error. This small perturbation, if we denote it as R, it is desired for the objective of the attacker is to have f of x plus R, the prediction of the model, equal to a desired label, L, the target label. Such that the image after adding the noise still remains close to the original image. And most of the work in doing this rely on iterative gradient computation. So it needs to compute the gradient of the loss with respect to the input. And that will be the perturbation you add to the original image. But computing the gradient, it's only possible if you first, you need to know like what is the model architecture, and you need to know what is the model weights and parameters in order to compute this gradient. So these approaches are only successful in a white box setting, where you have complete knowledge about the model and its internals. But black box attacks are more practical, because in practice, you will be willing to attack a model. You only have access to use it, but you don't have access to its internals, and you don't know its structure or its weight. So there have been research work about this, including the paper not et al. In 2016, that trained substitute models for using the result of query outputs to the victim model, and then they attack their own substitute model, and they hope that this attack will transfer to the other model. And there is other work by Chin et al. In 2017. This is one of state-of-art works in black box attacks. Instead of computing the exact gradient by knowledge of the model internals, they try to estimate an approximate gradient through only black box queries to the model. So they do a difference equation estimation. They change every pixel in the image a little bit, and they estimate what is the result of changing this pixel. How much does it affect the Karkek score probability? But the problem with these methods is that they are not efficient. They require doing a huge number of queries to the victim model. But if you have a limited access to the model, then you want to like do an attack with a small number of queries to prevent the model owner from knowing that something bad is happening. And that's why we introduced our work called GenAttack. So GenAttack is a black box attack against machine learning models. It can be done without knowing the internal model architecture or parameters. And it assumes that the attacker only has the capability to query the model as a black box function. So you feed an input, and you get the prediction scores out of the model without knowing anything about what's happening inside the model. And the idea is the following. Instead of relying on gradient computing, which requires knowledge of the model internals, or gradient approximate estimation, which requires a huge number of queries, we use a gradient-free optimization. So we don't even need to estimate or approximate the gradient. So, and using the gradient-free optimization, we can compute our adversarial examples. And right now, Yash is going to tell you more details about how does it work.
Okay, thank you, Mustafa. So how does our GenAttack work? So it's basically an implementation of genetic algorithms. It's based upon that. So how do genetic algorithms work? So first you initialize the population, and the way you do that is you make a bunch of random perturbations of the input, and that becomes your population. You then evaluate the fitness of each member. You want to see how good they are. And the way you evaluate the fitness in this case is look at the target prediction probability. How good are they at getting the model to misclassify? How good are they at being adversarial? If the example is already adversarial, you're done. You output it. If not, you need to start iterating. You need to start optimizing. So you then do random selection.
What is each individual population? It's perturbations of the image?
They're random perturbations of the image. So the way genetic algorithms work is that because you don't have access to the gradient, you don't know exactly what direction to go in, you try to search the space as efficiently as possible. So you try to randomly search and hit on all possible places. So you initialize the population with these random perturbations. You evaluate the fitness. Some are good, some aren't. You then, if you're done, you're done. If not, then you then select a few of these. And these are the parents, which is why they call genetic algorithms. And the selection is done with a probability proportional to the fitness score, because we would rather select parents which are good. The way you do crossover is you just randomly combine these parents, and you get out children, which is why it's called genetic algorithms. I'm not sure what you mean. The way we did it is just, so we have these are vectors basically, and we just did a random combination of the vector.
Oh, each individual?
Yes. So we have the, we do crossover, and then with a small probability, a mutation probability, we do mutation. And the mutation is just a random change. And so in this way, we try to explore the space very, very well. So now we're going to present our results. So we were expecting this attack would be good, but we were expecting that it would probably be more query efficient than the zoo attack, which is the current state of the art, because estimating the gradient is so costly. But genetic algorithms are known to have high computational complexity, so we weren't expecting that much of an improvement. However, we were very surprised. It was a tremendous improvement. So for example, here are the CIFAR-10 examples. So on the left, you can see the original label. On the top, you can see the predicted label. Clearly, these look like the original example. However, they're all classified as adversarial to each of the corresponding classes. So we're able to succeed against all of the classes. And we were also able to detect ImageNet models, which are the more realistic images. These are the larger scale, higher resolution images. We were able to detect ImageNet models. So for example, that example is a bird, a Carotto Gallerita. And we were able to get it to classify as a trolley bus. And it looks basically the same. So in terms of evaluation, here we found a big difference. So the current state of the art is zoo, which is estimating the gradient. So for MNIST and CIFAR-10, zoo and Genetech do pretty well. MNIST is a small-scale images. They're black and white, and they're numbers. CIFAR-10 are small-scale images, but they're color images. ImageNet images are larger-scale, high-resolution images. So the feature space is way bigger. It's harder to attack. Interestingly, zoo, because it's so computationally inefficient, it takes so many queries to estimate the gradient, it's not able to succeed on ImageNet in the targeted case. Targeted case meaning, instead of just getting the attack to the model to misclassify, which is very easy on ImageNet because there's so many classes, you could get it to misclassify from like an Arctic fox to a white fox, and that qualifies as an adversarial example. But for example, targeted case where you want it to get it classified as a trolley bus, zoo actually failed in this case relatively frequently, while Genetech didn't, basically due to the fact that it was actually tractable on ImageNet. So this really expresses the query efficiency. So we just measured the mean number of queries it took to compute a successful adversarial example. For MNIST, CIFAR-10, ImageNet, what zoo would do is they would try to run iterative optimization, and once they were successful, they would abort. So we were expecting that for MNIST and CIFAR-10, it would be much less queries. However, it wasn't. It was basically the same, only about 500,000 more on ImageNet, which is a lot, but seeing how inefficient zoo is, it's not that much in the relatively. However, for Genetech, for the smaller scale images, because they're easier and the feature space is smaller, we're able to succeed in a drastic fraction of queries. So about 2,000 times more query efficient. And for ImageNet, which are drastically larger feature space, we are 27 times more query efficient, which is very good. However, there is more improvement to be done just because it's a much, much harder case. So now we're going to attack defenses. So there's been a lot of defenses proposed, but the one defense which has kind of stood the test of time is adversarial training. And adversarial training is very, very natural. So what it is, we're weak against adversarial examples, let's train with them. And maybe we'll be robust against adversarial examples. So a few caveats in this. You can't just take a bunch of adversarial examples and then train with them and then expect to be extremely robust. So Madri, who's part of this MIT lab, they noticed that the way in which you can get this is you increase the model capacity. So assuming that adversarial examples are outside the distribution, the data distribution that the model has seen, which is pretty plausible for the fact that the model is misclassifying them, you need more capacity to be able to handle this larger data distribution. So for example, for MNIST, which is a relatively easy data set, they had to increase their model by 10 times to be robust to like small perturbation attackers. And also, instead of using FGSM, which is that single-step attacker in the direction of the gradient, use iterative attackers. And the reason why iterative attackers are better is because now instead of making a big jump, when you had to actually make like a curved jump, a nonlinear jump, you can make small iterative linear jumps, and that's approximately nonlinear. So there's a few methods. So the standard way is exactly what you would think. So while you're training, you supplant it with adversarial examples and keep going. However, there's a problem with that in that you're generating adversarial examples against a weak model because the model is currently training. You want the model to be robust to strong adversarial examples. Also, the adversarial example generation process is tied in with the model training. So you might learn some degenerate solution where the actual adversarial examples are weak, and it's because that will just minimize the loss because the only optimization objective here is the loss. So ensemble adversarial training separates these two things. You generate adversarial examples against an ensemble that's already been trained and you use that to train your original model. And they found much better results. And this actually was validated in the NIPS competition, which we talked about before. Almost all the defenses are based upon this model. So now we attack this model, which is found to basically be the most robust defense, and we were able to succeed. And it only took a few more queries than attacking a clean model, but still able to succeed. And I think it was about 100,000 for Inception V3, a clean model. It was 200,000 for the Ensemble Adversarial Training Defense. Took a little bit longer, but way more tractable than Zoo. And see, we can still, that's a sea anemone, and now it's a park meter. Next, we then tackle the big problem in machine learning, or adversarial machine learning. So Anish Athalye, who is also at MIT, he introduced this problem, obfuscated gradients. And this actually got awarded the ICML 2018 best paper, showing that it's a big problem in the community. So we found there was a bunch of defenses which were published in iClear 2018. He took the GitHub codes and he attacked them, and he found that, all of these defenses aren't really more robust. They're relying upon a phenomenon, which is why they have high robustness. So remember that before GenAttack, basically all attacks were gradient-based. So what they did was, instead of becoming actually robust to perturbations, we're just going to mess up the gradients so attackers fail. And they found three instances of this. So shattered gradients is when the defense renders a gradient to be non-existent or incorrect. Stochastic gradients is when they just make it randomized. So the gradient direction just becomes very random, becomes very hard to optimize. And exploding or vanishing gradients, where the gradients just start exploding. And again, these are all just harming optimization attacks, which are based on the gradient. So they had a bunch of methods to circumvent. So BPDA was just, let's analyze the model, find the non-differentiable component, and replace it with something that's approximately equal but differentiable. Now we succeed. Or EOT, which was for succeeding at stochastic gradients, where we, instead of just optimizing upon just one random sample of the defense, you just keep randomly sampling from the defense, so you optimize through the random transformation. And you hope to be robust to all the random perturbations it introduces. However, this only works in the white box case. You need to know what's a non-differentiable component to use BPDA. You need to know that this is a randomized defense to actually put in the computational budget to actually optimize through this transformation. However, as we discussed, GenAttack is gradient-free. It doesn't estimate the gradient. It doesn't need the gradient. So it should work against these defenses. We found that to be true. So bit depth, we attacked a bunch of non-differentiable input transformations, which are the normal ones that are used. So bit depth reduction is the images are represented using a limited number of bits. You cut off the last few bits, which is non-differentiable. These gradient-based attacks fail. We were able to succeed. For JPEG compression, you just take your image, you save it as JPEG, which compresses the image. This is a non-differentiable transformation. Our attack succeeded, Zoo failed. And TVM is it's a very costly attack. One, it's randomized, because the way it works, it's total variance minimization. So they do random dropout on the pixels, and then afterwards they minimize the total variation across the example. So one, it's very costly, because they're solving an optimization problem every time they do inference. And two, it's randomized, so it's much harder. Zoo, because it's so computationally costly, a little tidbit on that, to actually run Zoo on 100 ImageNet images, it takes 5 days on a TitanX GPU, which is relatively expensive. So when the actual inference is literally an optimization problem, Zoo becomes completely intractable. However, algorithm wasn't, and we were able to succeed about 70% of the time. So we targeted basically the number one defenses, adversarial training, which just stood the test of time, and obfuscated gradients, which is what almost all of the defenses currently are relying upon. So now we've discussed attacking models with limited access. Now we're going to discuss attacking natural language models. So why can't we just do the same thing we did with images in the natural language case? Well, natural language is different. First, words and text are discrete, unlike image pixels, which are continuous. So you might say, but word-to-vec, word embeddings, it maps these words to these vector representations. So how about you take the gradient, you go in the direction of the gradient, and you pick a word replacement which is in that direction of that gradient. However, with pixels and with images, you can make a worst-case perturbation, and you can make it imperceptible up to a very large-scale parameter. With natural language, if you change a single word, and you just change a single word so it maximizes the target label, it's going to probably have nothing to do with the sentence. And so it's going to be easily detected, and it's going to completely ruin the semantics of the sentence. So you can't really do that. Secondly, that word change needs to satisfy the language's grammar constraints. If you change a noun to a verb, even if it's related to the context of the sentence, it's going to make the sentence make no sense, and it's going to be easily detected. So these are all the difficulties, which is why it's very hard to apply gradient-based optimization. So how about we use GenAttack, genetic algorithms? So again, here's the same algorithm. And again, this is really the only, to our knowledge, the only algorithm in the literature which is able to actually make adversarial changes and get adversarial examples, which are semantically and syntactically similar. And also it's black box, which makes it practical. So the thing is, we did the exact same thing as before. The fitness is the target label prediction probability, all of these things, except the mutation is different. In the mutation, instead of just making a random change, we now want to make a change such that the word replacement is semantically and syntactically similar. So how do we do that? So first we compute the n nearest neighbors of selected word in the embedding space. So these are supposed to be similar. However, we did use a counterfeited embedding because actually in the embedding space, good and bad are very similar. Because these word embedding models are trained on co-occurrence, good and bad appear in similar contexts. However, if you replace good with bad, you completely ruined the semantics of the sentence. So the counterfeited embedding is, it takes these word embeddings and injects synonym and antonym sort of constraints. So that the only words that are close to this particular word are ones which appear in the same context and are synonyms. So the antonyms are found far away. Then after that, we have our nearest neighbors, but we don't know if they fit in the context. We don't know if they're the right part of speech, all of these things. Then we take a language model, which is used to predict the next word in a sentence. So if the next word is something which doesn't appear in that context, the probability would be low. So we use the language model to predict the probability of that word given the previous word in the sentence, and we filter out words which don't fit in the context. So now we have words which are semantically similar and syntactically similar, and at that point we now perform the replacement by maximizing the target probability. So we have these synonym constraints, semantic and syntactic constraints, and then we try to make the replacement based on the target probability. And we actually found very good results. So for example, this is the IMDb dataset, which is a classic dataset for sentiment analysis. And as you can see here, this review is very negative. It's negative, and the original text prediction was negative with 78% confidence. However, all the algorithm did was it changed terrible to horrific, which is a synonym, and it changed regarded to considered to regarded, which is another synonym, and it changed kids to youngsters, which is another synonym, and now it classifies it as positive, which is a vulnerability, and it's actually a true adversarial example because it retained the semantics and syntactics. Next, we attack textual entailment. So what textual entailment is you have some premise, some situation, you could say, and then you have some hypothesis. And then the model predicts whether this hypothesis entails the premise, contradicts the premise, or is neutral to the premise. So for example, in this original prediction, a runner wearing purple strives for the finish line. The hypothesis, the runner wants to head to the finish line. So this does entail the premise, which is correct. However, the adversarial example was it just replaced runner with racer, which is a synonym, so it should still entail the premise. However, the model predicts contradiction. So that's definitely a problem. The second example, it's now one that's originally a contradiction. The premise is a man and a woman stand in front of a Christmas tree contemplating a single thought. The hypothesis is two people talk loudly in front of a cactus, which does not entail the premise, so it's a contradiction. However, if you change people talk to humans chit-chat, now it says it entails the premise, which is clearly wrong. So now I'm going to pass it over to Mustafa. We're going to talk about the open problems in speech recognition.
Thanks, Yash. Those are kind of modalities that the machine learning models typically accept in our nowadays world is the speech modality. And of course, like many of us have in their homes, these smart speakers that can listen to your voice commands and apply it. For example, Siri and Google Home, you can ask them to do online transactions for you. So the equivalent of adversarial attacks in speech recognition world is the following. You want to like produce some word, such as like a human who listens to it. When Blake will say that this word is yes, while the machine learning model will conflict with this. It will say no, and this word was a no. While it still sounds for the human as a yes. And we did this work, it was published in NIPS Machine Conception Workshop 2017. It is a black box attack on speech recognition model using, again, our genetic algorithm optimization approach. So the victim model we used, and there was another work by Carlini from UC Berkeley, which was doing white box attack against speech to text recognition models. Our work was against speech commands data set, which recognize like a single command word, like yes, no, up, down, and so. But Carlini's work, it is a white box, but it can perform attack against a whole sentence classification model. So we have found we can achieve very high success rate. So for example, every word in the dataset, the GIS can be converted to be misclassified as an O with 96% accuracy, attack success rate, and it can be targeted to be misclassified as an up with 80% under the same limit of perturbation we add to the input audio waveform. And we qualify it, what is the human perception of the words after you add this adversarial noise. So we have found that on average, like 90% of human listeners were recruited for this study, they still recognize the word as the source label, the original label, even though the model will misclassify it as the target label. And 9% of them will say that this word is a unknown word for me, or like it's a corrupted word, and only 1% of them recognize it as the target word. But the challenge right here in this problem right now is that this work on our adversarial attack against speech recognition model, they assume you have a direct access to the model. So you can feed your audio directly in the model as an input. But there is no equivalent yet for physical warlike attacks against speech recognition model. For example, in case of images, there is this physical warlike attacks against image recognition model, like the adversarial batch we have seen shown before, which is like a physical warlike sticker. Or there is this work by Alexey Krokin and the MIT team, is like taking a picture of adversarially printed image, and it will still remain adversarial. But in physical war like adversarial attack against speech recognition, if you play the adversarial audio from a speaker and record it on the other side from a microphone and feed it into the model, it will no longer become adversarial. So that remains an open challenge. It's how to develop robust over-the-air adversarial audio attacks. So as a reminder, there are still many open challenges. We just like to highlight a few of them and the work we have done for each one of them. And we'll be happy to accept your questions. Yes, exactly. We have a constraint on the L infinity norm. No, we developed our own. And actually, most of our work is available as open source. Any other questions? Thank you.